72 something, okay, and this is what we're doing.
We have to always work backwards?
We're setting the rate going back to May 1st.
Right.
We're not setting it for the.
Going forward from there.
Yeah, so it's kind of like reverse of everybody else's cycle.
Yeah, okay.
You know, so we're only having to cover the 672.
Okay.
With these numbers.
Good, then it will work.
So then it'll work very well.
Yeah, and it gives us more money for reserve or however it's going to be allocated and stuff like that.
Because I know in '17, it looked like the budget increased significantly.
Right.
Yes, it did, to the 672.
About $90,000, then it was a $345,000 capital expense also.
A lot of the information that was in that study, I spoke with Kevin this morning on, and he thinks that a lot of them are actually higher than what it's going to be.
Higher or lower?
Higher. The estimate is higher than what it will actually be. In other words, I think there was $35,000 allocated to repair the pump station at the beginning of Captain Lathrop, and he didn't think that was going to be anywhere near that amount. They're in the process of getting quotes, I think, to do that INI thing, but he did say that the state is definitely going to require that by the December 17. I think that it has to be done by then, so. Whether or not, you know, there's water, and if it helps out the operations of the thing at all, it doesn't seem to matter. They want to make sure none of it's going in there.
So it was a significant increase from 674 to 9.
Yeah.
But it does give the town a little more money to work with.
Yes.
Which is a good thing.
It's significant, but there's going to be significant for the next several years as well.
But it's, yeah, and that's the thing. And it's still, even at that, at the good 30% of the household, I mean, it's still just about $16 a month. It's not a real, I understand that the bill is tripled, but it's still only $16 a month, so, to get rid of.
The budget number is 672, 711.
Okay.
Yeah.
I recall hearing that we are not eligible for grants because the rate is too low, right? Am I right with that?
I heard something of that, too.
Will this new rate make us eligible for grants? Does anybody know?
I don't know, but did, am I mistaken to read that it needed to be somewhere upwards of $15?
No. It was a percentage of medium income, wasn't it?
Yeah, which came out.
1%, 1%.
Which we were.
And we were working on 60.
$650 or $700 a year?
Yeah.
Depends on which figure. There's two figures out there. One is $63,700, I believe, and the other one is 68. 68, so I'm not sure which one, so.
That's a significant increase, so, you know, even, you know, the $200 is going up three times. To jump up to $600 or $700, that would be huge.
Right, which.
So we don't know, though.
We have nobody's done, I didn't do the calculation.
You'd have to do the calculations throughout the whole town, because that would put a minimum of $400. That would be the minimum, though, is $400.
Mm-hmm.
And, of course, that average would go up from there when you start taking in everybody, so.
Right.
So it was, so it went, so the rate went up, it went up from $674.
Yeah.
To $9.32. $9?
$9.79.
No, it was, that was my proposal, over the side, the bold town rate.
The select board last night determined $9.
Oh, okay.
And I was working off of next year's.
So that's 25%.
Does the 5%, is the 5% of $9 or 5% of $9.32? Or does it matter? Too small to worry about, huh?
We didn't do the 9%.
Pardon?
Okay, so it like brings up the average bill to, well, if it was to like $550 to $600, you know, it's still short of.
A little bit.
But at least it's a, at least it's an incremental start.
$2.26 per thousand gallons.
Yeah.
Plus the minimum change on the.
Which is $150.
Yeah.
So the reserve is still going to be a .47?
That didn't happen. Anything in the middle box didn't happen.
Yeah, but down below,
I know down below.
You've got it in there that we're going to add 36,131 in bold.
I apologize for that.
Right.
That's incorrect.
So that's wrong?
Yep.
So the, we did add it to the reserve fund will only be the 132,150?
That's correct.
That's correct.
Bruce, you're an expert. How many gallons are used on the conventional boil?
Four to six.
How many?
Four to six in there?
Yeah, gallons?
Yeah, conventional.
Yeah, conventional is four to six.
So if it's 0.9 cents, right, and you've got six times $5, it'd be 5.4 cents every time you flush your toilet. In my calculation.
I'm not going to go.
Close to right, I don't know. But I'm just saying, that's scary.
Well,
just
for a point of information, that a few weeks ago, I was in a meeting in Northampton, and the director of the USDA was there and said that, you know, that they have a lot of monies available in for communities to deal with sewers as well as multiple of other projects. And they don't give outright grants. Like if, say, we had a project that was going to be $500,000, they won't give us a grant for $500,000. But what they would do is if you apply for it and finance it through them, and they have pretty attractive rates, anywhere from 1% to 3%, that they would give you up to 25 to 35% as a grant. So, you know, if it were going to be $500,000, you'd probably get, you know, $130,000. That's right.
Who's this?
You know, the USDA, Small Communities Grants, and it's primarily...
We don't qualify for them.
No, that is not sewer-related. It's for any infrastructure projects like that. And
you could do infrastructure.
Right. Or, you know, and there was other things that you could do. I mean, one of the things that, you know, I was interested in is they were talking about, you know, whether you're building a building for an ambulance or even an ambulance themselves. So... I don't want to get this too long off the subject, but I mentioned it to our ambulance director, and he hadn't looked into it, so I did. And this guy, he basically said, you know, we're begging you to come and apply for this. So I called Hadley, and I spoke with this woman, and, you know, she was very helpful, just like he said. And, you know, all of the terms that he had mentioned, she, you know, reiterated it. But then I asked about coming in to apply for it. She says, well, we don't have any money right now. And I said, well, that's totally a contradiction to what, you know, Mr. Sora said the other night. He said that we have tens of millions of dollars and we're really looking to give it away. And she goes, well, I don't know where you got the information from. But so I'm waiting. She said she was going to call me back, but that was yesterday. I haven't heard yet.
Was that called a small town
grant? Something like that, yeah.
Yeah. Dave Kaczynski, the president of the Mass Rural Water Association, informed me about a month ago that the USDA offered grants, essentially, very attractive loans, just
right.
Like you're saying. Same thing. He said the same thing to me.
But and it isn't, they won't give you all the grant money,
no.
But if you apply for their loan program,
yeah.
That's where they give you
right.
the grant. Yeah. And
you can
like,
borrow at a very attractive rate. And then get a big chunk for free.
For free. And there's no prepayment penalty, so you can keep it for a year or two, and then you could pay it off if you chose to
yeah.
do so. He said it was very flexible.
Keep it a week.
I don't know. But I have to admit, when I talked with the woman he told me to talk to, you know, the story changed. So.
Right.
But it's something I'm still going to look into it.
Well, I can tell you one thing. When the people get their bills for the summer bill,
yep.
They're reading the meters now, and it went up 33.53% on the water consumption, plus the minimum charge is going up. You're going to have a lot of people in on Wednesday night to visit.
Well, you know, I mean, I understand that. But one of the things, though, is that if I'm not mistaken, there's 20% of the people are below the minimum anyways. But by raising that minimum water bill, you also increase the usage of the water before they get charged more. Do you know what I'm saying? Because even though we raise the rate to $9, they could use more gallons before their bill would go above that $200 range.
If, as gallons go into the plant, do the operating costs must go up as well, right? Or is most of them fixed?
That's a very difficult question to answer. It largely depends on strength. It's not necessarily a function of flow. If the water's very strong, has strong VOD and high TSS, yes. If it's mainly just rainwater, the biggest threat from that would be washout of solids out of the system, loss of microbes, possible TSS violation on permit, but costs?
I'm thinking usage, people, so it wouldn't be rainwater.
Oh, yeah, definitely.
People flushing the toilet, taking an extra shower because they don't care.
Oh, yeah, very much. It does. It's almost direct. The stronger, the more you get of normal strength, the more it's going to cost to treat. That's right.
Okay.
Yeah. Wasn't there a Mass Works grant in the process that somebody was applying for?
Yes.
Kevin knows more about it. I guess we should.
I spoke with him this morning about it, and we're supposed to hear something before the end of the month, so, yeah.
Yay.
I'd like to go back to Bob.
Sure.
One of the reasons that I think that the select board voted to increase substantially is if you do a little moving around with a spreadsheet, you'll find that one, we had to do something with the service connection, period. I mean, that's okay. On the usage aspect, where it was $40 out of using an 805 rate would allow you 4,970 gallons. And in that 4,970 gallons, you had 84 customers, 41 which are businesses or other non-residential occupied buildings. So you had 50% of them that were not individual residences.
Post office.
I didn't even include the ones that, post office, but you have, I don't want to go where they are, but.
Any low use, they have one or two employees.
Yep.
They don't have a lot of people coming in using.
But there's 41 of those out of 84.
Right.
Would have fallen into that 40 category. Moving it up to the 100, which is what they did. And there again, I based mine on $8.05 because evidently Bruce and Bruce were working up the same avenue because I got the same numbers, 150, the 50 for, but okay, so, and we hadn't even talked about it. But if you spread that out and if you go up to the $100 bracket, at that point in time, you still have you incorporate 223 customers. That would be 12,422 gallons. You have 223 customers that use that or below, of which 91, again, are not residential owner occupied. So you had a lot of people. I want to be careful how you look at that.
Inexpensive sewer disposal.
Not really paying their fair share for the disposal. So that's,
So at $200, it must have made significant change.
Pardon?
At $200, an increase of 100.
I only went up to 100. Okay.
So now if it's $200, it's double that, so.
Well, the majority, the highest percentage of businesses on those spreadsheets that are using less than that minimum mm-hmm. are actually within that $150 down.
Okay.
It starts to thin out pretty good once you get above that.
That's what I thought.
Okay, because they're way above there. But you get into that lower bracket, you got 91 out of 223.
Yeah, that's a lot.
That is a lot. And so it's kind of weighing apples, trying to find a balance somewhere in between as far as I'm concerned.
And the other part, too, is my rough math with raising those minimums. So, instead of being charged for extra water at the 6,500 gallons, it goes up to like 22,000 gallons before it changes. And that addresses the issue of promoting more conservation, which, then could affect the sewer bill because they're not generating the money. It could affect the water rates because they're not using the water. And the flow would go down and maybe cause more problems for the operation. So I think it was a good compromise to deal with a lot of different, those three different issues. And,
You're going to catch it all. That's okay, I've been there, I know what that's all about.
Yeah.
Come in to use these toilets.
That's right.
It's a nickel they're going to save every time they stop by.
But, you know, and what I said to Kevin this morning is that of everything that the town provides for its citizens, if you needed to, we could live without a police department, we could live without a fire department, I don't know about, we could probably live dangerously without an ambulance, but you got to flush your toilet, you know, you can't flush your toilet, nobody's going to show up for work anywhere, you know, there's going to be issues.
Come down to the town hall because it's free.
Yeah. They are going to start paying for it.
Yeah.
But, you know.
Are you going to put a meter on the bathrooms here?
No, we have a water meter coming into the building, don't we?
I haven't seen it listed.
Well, it's going to be. I think the town, I know that Doug sent out three letters, and I know Wendy sent out another one to all the schools and everybody involved.
You mean senior center, library, all the time?
Exactly.
All the municipal buildings?
Town garage.
Town garage.
Water department, fire department.
Fire department, everything.
And build.
Yes. Yep.
What's it going to cost to put those meters in?
Oh, there are meters.
What?
There are meters.
For water.
Oh, there already are?
Yes.
They already get billed for water.
I thought you were going to put one in this building.
Oh, there is a meter here.
Oh, so.
So you just need to.
They just weren't billed.
Just need to turn it on and bill it.
I don't want to see them spending $2,000 to put a meter in, okay? Because it's not going to be, you know, cost effective.
We, go ahead, Bruce.
Barbara sent out some flows and bill analysis spreadsheets for the whole Deerfield and Deerfield. When I looked at the Deerfield one, I specifically looked at Frontier. Frontier is not a metered use. It's a 518,000-gallon fixed use. It's the only fixed use on the entire list.
But the selectmen changed that. They agreed that they just bill them a certain amount, and that's it. And that's wrong.
I'm just telling you that it's an issue we have to correct.
Well, it.
It won't correct unless you have a metered reading.
Well, that's exactly what we did. We know, I wanted to do it retroactive. Carolyn's position was that it was unfair to burden any of these organizations, if you will, because they hadn't had time to budget it. But they know now that going forward, they are going to get billed at whatever rate we decide, you know, and they're going to pay accordingly, so.
I would, and that's good.
I think it is. It's fair. I mean, it's absolutely fair.
They should pay their fair share.
Because like I said before, you know, this is my town hall, even though I don't have sewer, it's still my town hall. And that, you know, you as a sewer user should not subsidize my town hall. Well, I don't go to the bathroom. I don't go to the bathroom here.
So does that mean you're full of it?
Yeah. Well, I have seen places that they do it a little better. You can get into the bathroom free, but they have a coin thing on the paper machine, so.
No.
Yeah.
They tried that in California back in the 1970s, and so many people complained that it was made illegal in the state of California to charge people to go to the bathroom.
I have to put my other hat on as a member of the Frontier School Committee. Frontier has an irrigation system.
Yep.
And it needs to be an adjustment made for the, what goes through the meter for the irrigation system.
Well, I think.
I think that's why those figures were adjusted years ago.
I heard they had 2 meters.
They may.
That's what I heard.
I heard they had 2 meters, and what they did was, I complained about it because one six-month period, they had a bill. They took what went in, they deducted for what went out their fields, and when they got through, they got a $700 bill for 6 months for like 700 people.
I know.
And I got a bill for a two-family house for 5 people for $540.
I don't.
So they're paying $160 more. Instead of having 5 people, they get 700 in there. And that's the inequity that's been there.
Right.
It's been there for a long time.
I think it's fair to pay whatever you go domestically, right? But what's used out in the fields has to be excluded from the calculation.
But.
You're gonna do that to everybody that.
I think that's the only way it's fair to do it.
Right, but it's not expensive. Wherever their water goes out to their fields, they could add a meter right there.
Well, and show that water. I got an irrigation.
Nobody would read the meter. The water department refused to read the meter. That's what the issue was. So I said, if that's the case, then we'll send in our superintendent to take a one reading and deduct it off.
So the school didn't, if the water department didn't read the meter, how did they know what to bill for water?
We only read the water meter, not the irrigation meter.
They wouldn't, the water department did not want to read it because they didn't want to have to do an extra calculation.
There's someone coming in with a comment.
So if I have an irrigation system in my lawn?
Yes.
Yeah, see, that's slippery slope.
I want to be excluded too on that water.
You already are.
Nobody else gets that benefit. No one gets that benefit.
How am I?
Residential customers are billed at no more than 125% of their.
Oh, in the summer.
Their winter bill.
I read somewhere that either the residential or the commercial industrial, one of the two cannot get abatements.
What's that, Bruce, in here?
Either the residential or the commercial industrial are not allowed abatements.
That's on the sheet that they signed for, the select board signs, copy of those four things that Barbara sent.
Is this what you're talking about?
The sign-off sheet.
That's where it was, yes.
That's it.
So commercial industrial, is that what it was?
Yeah.
Does not receive an abatement?
Right.
On here it says abatements issued for private residents, there's no business or tenant occupied.
That's correct.
Right, okay. Not the same words, but.
Same, yeah, but that's.
Yeah.
I'm not sure if that's what.
And that's the way it's been several years now.
But I think what.
I'm not following your point, but that.
The point is that residential get an abatement if they exceed 125% of the winter use. They can request an abatement, and the abatement has to be.
Automatic.
Automatic, but it has to, can't be any less than $25, I think.
Right.
Right.
That's what it said.
Yeah, no less than $25.
So if you had a $20 abatement coming, you're not gonna get it.
Right.
Not worth the paperwork.
Not worth the paperwork on the town side. So do you understand the abatement? Well, it's only residential, you know, you only get an abatement after they exceed 125% of their winter rate usage.
And the abatement is for the difference?
The difference. Anything over 125%, yes.
It's automatic?
Yeah, that way, because they assume that they're using it for sprinklers or their garden, and it's not going through the sewer system, so they automatically give them that money back.
Is this unique to this town?
They don't automatically give it back.
Because most towns, the more you use, the more you pay.
No, you don't apply for it.
You give it back automatically.
Wow, that's a big plus.
I've never seen that.
That's not really promoting conservation, especially during a drought. And most towns, the more you use, the more you pay.
Well, that's only the sewer. That's only the sewer. It's not the water rate.
This is for watery gardens or.
The water rate you pay for what you use. This is only the sewer rate.
So assuming that you are watering.
Okay.
Or you're using garden for gardening.
And a good example, if you went through the spreadsheets, there's individuals that use over 300,000 gallons of water. But if you go back their past records several years, you'll see their usage, their winter usage is around 30 to 40,000 gallons.
Okay.
So it bumps, you know, in summertime, you know, so.
Hmm.
So it's pretty, you know, if you look at their records, it's pretty consistent in the lower end for the winter months.
Hmm. Okay.
But several years back, they were billing out for what end, and you had a lot of residential customers who ended up with, you know, $2,000 bills for water when they really weren't. And nobody was really receptive to setting up a 2-meter system in the town.
Yeah. Yeah, that's largely unpopular nationwide, I believe. Nobody really does that. It's problematic on the sewer end, particularly with solids. you know, they get, especially with non-dispersibles going through the pipe, same problem that I have would happen at the residential end prior to even making it into the...
On the outflow end.
Yeah.
If you put a meter on the outflow.
Exactly. That's a big problem.
Yeah.
Yeah, it was just anything solid, like a Clorox wipe. Put that down there, good luck with the meter.
Yep.
Because most of the meters...
Unless you use a mag meter.
Well, most of the meters are not mag meters, those are expensive.
Right.
Most are just a little, like a little fin that just turns around. And it's designed that way because it can be extremely low flow at times.
Yeah.
You know, especially if you have a 1.5 gallon flush. By the time it gets into that pipe, the level's very low, but, so it needs to be able to pick that up. But then that actually compounds solid material coming through because it's low velocity and it's very quick to hang up on any obstruction in that pipe. So really the only effective way would be magnetic flow meter because there's nothing in the pipe itself. It just measures through it using magnetic lines of flux and then the flow disrupts those magnetic lines of flux and it's calibrated to read that difference and give you a gallons per minute output from it. And that we use at both plants, we have mag meters for flow internally. So, but well. Yeah, at a residential household, that would be any kind of thing other than a mag meter would be definitely a problem. And mag meters are very expensive. Yeah, that would be a huge cost to put all that in. A mag meter in everyone's house, that would be really expensive.
Sorry. Really. How expensive are they?
Well, I mean, the larger you go, of course, the more they are. I don't have any idea what one on, say, a residential sewer line would be. I really don't, but... I bet you're looking at least $1,000 a pop.
Wow.
And you're going to need a meter pit.
Yeah, vault.
Outside your house.
Yeah, and certified people to put it in and calibrate it and check it. And
somebody's go around and read them every
day. Yeah.
They have attachments you can put right on your faucet outside to meter.
Mm-hmm. We're talking about the sewer.
Sewer. Yeah, your sewer outfall. Yeah.
Well, that's expensive.
Yeah. It is.
Well, let's get back to, you know, what we think about a sewer rate going forward. You know, there was a lot of discussion about, you know, a flat rate billing weekly or monthly or, you know, all those different things. I mean, I don't think we came to any, you know, good conclusion is what would be the best way of going forward.
Can I bring up something for... Can I bring up something for consideration?
Yeah, sure.
Now, I'm not proposing that this happens in the future of the town, but there has been discussion, again, I'm not proposing, that non-sewer users will pay for some of the capital improvements that occur in the future to the sewer plants because they're getting the benefit of the payment by industry in town. So that could wind up being in your general real estate tax bill. So I just think we need to maybe keep that in mind when we're discussing rates or what the rate method will be. You follow me? You with me on this?
Mm-hmm.
I think it also could affect whether we consider it as an enterprise fund. So we need to keep that in mind.
Yeah, I agree.
I'm just putting it on the table, that's all.
Yep.
Well, I think that that our goal should be to have sewer users pay for the sewage treatment plant and if it becomes necessary to ask the septic users to pitch in also, then fine. But that our goal should be to find a way, figure out a way for the sewage users to pay for the upgrades to the upgrades and the operating costs.
There's a difference that you're talking about, though. You're talking about upgrades and you're talking about sewer use. The regular operational fee, all the electricity, the flushing of the pipes and everything else should be paid for by the sewer users. Mm-hmm. No ifs, ands, or buts. Operational costs. Any other cost that's not operational, like studies, like plant improvements, major improvements that are in the road. I don't own the sewer in the road. The town owns the road. There's no reason why I should have to pay 100% of those fees. That's like this bylaw that was passed. It was bypassed because we never thought it was going to go through. We just didn't do nothing to counter the argument at the time.
What was that? I just don't know.
That was the argument where they say only sewer users will pay for the fee.
I see, yep.
And in theory, it sounds good, except for one thing. There is a fact that you're getting over $2 million from industrial and commercial. Why don't we use some of that money? And if we're going to use some of that money, that means that all that money won't go to subsidize everybody else in the whole town. And if they don't, that means the rate has to go up a little bit. But so what?
That is a good point, but there are, and I don't have the numbers off the top of my head, but there are quite a few commercial developments in this area that have, you know, private sewers as well. And that.
Private sewers don't get billed.
I understand that. But also, you know, if you go that far, our highway superintendent is also our sewer commissioner as well.
He gets paid 1/6 of his money for that.
He does.
Mm-hmm. He gets 1/6 of the salary.
Well, he comes from that.
He gets charged right directly to the sewer.
Okay. Okay.
I think, and I just can go from memory, and some days I get a little fuzzy, but I think when they first, the town meeting first talked about establishing billings for sewer charges, I think it was explained to people that the charge for the operations would come from the ratepayers, but the town would still be responsible for the capital outlay. And I don't know if I can prove it, but that's what I remember going way back. And like I say, I'm getting kind of fuzzy. Maybe I'm not recalling it right, but I think that's what this when it was originally sold, that's what how it was sold.
Well,
and we're talking 35 years ago, probably.
I think that
George Bell may have been on the board at the time, because I know I filed an appeal on the way they did the charge, because I didn't think it was fair and equitable, but
right.
I didn't get anywhere.
Well, I think it's going to be very interesting to see where this Headworks project grant comes in. And I mean, if we get it, like we're anticipating it, that's going to be huge. And that, you know, just knowing of these other grants through the USDA, I mean, we're not going to dig up the entire town in a year anyways. It's going to be done in steps. So if this might be a multi-tiered endeavor where, you know, you could get a short-term loan and get some grant money. So the entire amount's not going to have to be generated by the sewer users and or the town. So I don't know how that necessarily is going to play in. I think it's going to be something you have to apply for and see how it goes. I mean, obviously, you don't want to wait 10 years and say, oh, no, you know, it just didn't work at all. But I think that's something that, you know, should be figured into this whole equation going forward.
Five- or 10-year capital plan of $32 million. At some point, we've got to go over that list and say, what do we recommend and what don't we recommend?
Mm-hmm. Exactly.
Right.
Yeah.
Also, may I throw something out and just a thought? Again, not a proposal, just something for discussion. Maybe we need to look at it down the road. Maybe we don't. But I'm trying to listen to John. I've heard Bob bring this up, too, as far as fair and equitable in. I was just thinking that if we do get to a point, we could possibly establish a sewer stabilization fund for the capital improvements. And if you assessed for betterment assessment of each individual in town, $50 per year. And I know that doesn't sound like a lot, but when you start doing the figures here, you get 5,000 plus residents. But it would only stop there. It also, I think we go back to the schools and the industry and so on and so forth. Whatever they have on tap as far as population during the days, it's a $50 per person there too. And you could end up, you know, who knows, as far as the numbers being employed here, as far as, you know, these companies. And if you're doing $50 per person across the board, residential, industrial, commercial, institutional, and that means the private schools too.
Interesting.
If you do that, you can generate, I believe you could generate, you know, maybe up to somewhere to $500,000 a year, and actually label that for your capital improvement stabilization fund.
Yeah, but how do you bill it though?
and you bill it on, based on population, and the bill goes to industry.
I thought poll taxes were illegal in Massachusetts.
What was?
You don't have to.
Poll taxes.
If it's a betterment, if it's a betterment fee, you can't.
I don't know.
I don't know, that's what I'm asking.
I've never heard of a fee like that, that's what I'm trying to figure out.
I like that idea.
That's why the simplest way is to pay.
It's going to drive businesses out of town.
The tax base has, knowing that they bring in $2.2 million.
Well, I was just trying to keep it as simple as possible.
I don't know, I don't know how you.
I don't know if that's legal, not, it's just, it's.
If I'm a business owner in town, maybe I'll think, gee, maybe I ought to leave town.
Everyone's raising their rates everywhere.
You know, it's.
Where are they going to go?
I don't think it's very conducive to business, I don't know what kind of, say, I don't know how many people is Yankee Candle employed in Deerfield? Anybody got an idea?
300.
300, 400.
So 800 times 50?
Oh, what's it going to do?
$40,000.
Well, if you're going to set a different rate for them.
What are you going to do with the schools?
Could be a job.
Are you going to exempt them?
Well, then you got.
No, you don't exempt.
That would be huge, you know, I mean, the budget for schools.
For the schools?
Yeah.
For the day students, the boarding students, because it's different. Okay?
You got one living there, and you already.
Okay, throw that out of your off the table, and we'll just go back to, we'll just go back to sewer users paying for the whole thing. My thought process was that you could do that for a 5 or 10 year period to build up a stabilization fund for capital improvements, and use a sunset clause to it, so it disappears, once you have that money.
Done by the number of fixtures you had in your house.
Right.
You got a bill based upon the number of fixtures and how many units were in it, and that's what you got as a bill. You had two toilets, and a washing machine hookup, and a kitchen sink, right, and a tub. It was all calculated out, and you got a bill, that was before they had the meters.
Maybe as a committee, we need to decide one way or the other, whether we want non-sewer users to help with the capital costs of the plant.
And how we're going to assess that.
And then go, you know, decide that first, and then decide how.
You raise an appropriate for taxation, that money, and it gets added to the tax rate, all right?
But how much?
Well, whatever it's determined, and you got to deal with 2.5 and the rest of the stuff.
What about having a fee like 2 to 5 cents, or something along these lines, for every sale made at any business in town? So that it would be passed on to the customers.
We don't have the right to do our own taxation without going to the state.
Because I know a lot of towns are doing that for dining.
There is, that's a lot.
Meals tax.
Meals tax.
Alive in town, you'd have to pay a poll tax, because that's illegal, they made that illegal, you can't do that.
You could ask the town meeting to designate the money they collect from the local meals tax and the local room occupancy tax to go to the sewer fund.
Well, something like that, because when you use, I worked this last weekend, there was people parking on the lawn over there at Yankee Candle, it was so crowded. I mean, if all of those people paid a little something for all the candles they buy, or whatever, they use in the bathroom.
If they use a bathroom, then their water use goes up, and they do pay more.
They do pay.
They do pay, you know, they do pay more, because their water use goes up.
No, Yankee Candle pays, he's talking about the consumer.
Consumers.
People buying the candles.
Add a little bit of money to it.
When they went to a restaurant, they paid the local option meals tax, okay? They bought an ice cream cone, they paid that, right?
Right.
They bought a cupcake.
They buy 3 cases of candles, they're paying dearly.
I talk about a tiny bit, but those, it's like putting pennies in a piggy bank.
Yeah.
It just keeps adding up and adding up and adding up. I mean, it's like a trickle feed constant.
Well, I think that's the dollar amount is the important thing, in that, you know, it's kind of our job, if you will, is to sort out, you know, how we want to charge the rates, and if we want to have, you know, like different rates for commercial and industrial and institutional.
Right, I think we need to keep it simple.
Yeah.
And only because I have spoken with Barbara Hancock, the treasurer, and she is very much opposed to monthly billing. She might accept quarterly, but it would make it very difficult.
It's a lot of work, I think.
But that's only cash flow. That's not going to change how much money comes in total. It's just how much money they have to borrow from the bank.
So, right.
They don't borrow.
So I don't think.
Well, then how much money they don't have to borrow.
It's how much work they have in the office.
That's right.
No, I'm talking about if we do it or don't. The only, it's the work plus cash flow. It doesn't affect total dollars.
Right, it doesn't affect the total dollars. I don't know if that's something that we should be.
I could tell you, but I would guess that she's opposed to it because she doesn't have the staff to.
Right.
That's what.
Take care of it.
I don't know if anybody realizes how she gets the information, how she gets the data from Old Deerfield and South Deerfield.
I know she gets it, but I don't know how.
Okay. Old Deerfield, she gets the written meter readings from the Old Deerfield, handwritten meter readings.
From Brian Nardowitz.
From Brian.
Yeah.
And so they're on a piece of paper and they're all handwritten. She has to manually input every meter reading.
And those are quarterly readings.
He has a computer in his office.
Those are quarterly readings besides.
She does it quarterly.
In cubic feet.
In cubic feet, then she has to make conversions. She has a program for it, so to make all the conversions, but it's just, I mean, there's $19,000 administration in their budget just to pay for that. South Deerfield.
I'm sorry, but, so a question, Bruce, would she be as opposed to a monthly billing if there was a flat fee so she knew every month how much she?
She would not be opposed to it.
Why are we even discussing switching to monthly? What's that going to gain us?
Well, the reason is that the.
Perceived increases.
The perceived increase is easier to handle, especially if there's.
Oh, psychological.
Psychologically, and also people are used to paying small amounts of money every month.
Okay.
Which they don't see that their cell phone ends up being $2,400 a year. It's $200 a month. And I can afford $200 a month. And the other observation that I have as a business owner is that a lot of my customers, they can't come up with $500. They can't come up with a $500 down payment on a car. They can't come up with $600 to pay the sales tax. They have to finance everything. So when they get a sewer bill of $600 every 6 months, and it's going to be more, they go into a panic because they don't have the money. They find it hard to budget.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Now I see the reason.
So it's a budget issue.
But, you know, if we just took it and assessed the sewer users on a flat fee and nothing done with the water consumption, it would cut out that $19,000 in administrative costs.
Major.
Because once you input it, the fact that they were a sewer user and they got their $1,200 assessment, $600 on one 6 month bill and $600 on the other, it's done and it's over, and you don't have $20,000 in administrative costs going down the tube. I mean, that's.
So if you eliminate the other, yeah, because in Deerfield is the other side of the South Deerfield district, hands her a printout that's 3 inches thick of all the readings that they take.
Why is that allowed? Why is it that they both have computers?
Because there's a separate districts and they have.
No, I think what he's saying is that why don't they
provide
give it
in electronic format?
Electronic
why
format?
Is it automated?
Because they give it to us for nothing. Okay. And in order to make it their idea, you've got to convince them it's their idea.
No, all you have to do is so make it mandatory that
Old
will not accept
does it. Old Deerfield uses.
They can care less.
Old Deerfield uses QuickBooks. Well, those two programs would not be compatible. I almost guarantee that.
I'll bet they could find a way to download it from QuickBooks.
Okay.
Yeah, that's a good program, actually.
And then South Deerfield, I'm not sure what they use, but she suggested if they could tag the sewer, she would tell who the sewer, tell South Deerfield who the sewer users are. And she put an S behind their code name number. She would eliminate 3/4 of the work she has to do.
They could just change the account number to put an S with it.
Exactly.
Yeah.
So that's
the cost of the district. Everybody's got sewer, it's got an S account number.
Understand. That's what she's saying. That would save her a lot of effort. Because she's taking what she knows as residential use and going through the, all the papers.
Wow.
Pulling out the ones, she has one of the staff doing it.
Boy, that's a dinosaur in today's world.
No, I understand. So that's something that we as a committee can make a suggestion on, but that would be definitely a savings. And it would.
Who determined, why doesn't she just do it?
Right. Why doesn't she just say, from now on, starting as of this date, only electronic format of this kind?
No, no, put it besides that you change your calendar.
I'll talk with her about it and see what, but I like.
You have to realize that the water districts are supplying this gratis to the town.
Right.
Okay?
They're making the readings, they're providing us the data, and they're providing the data in the form that they have it. So they're doing all the work for the town so they can make a sewer bill.
Yeah, see, I mean, they have to make it their idea is to, you could really help us out if you did it this way. But you can't tell them what to do. You can try to tell them what to do.
They're not gonna do it.
They get their backs up and they'll nothing.
For a couple minutes, why don't we kick around that idea of just a flat rate, or a flat fee, a flat fee?
Okay.
I don't wanna start using, and you know, sitting here, I could think, well, geez, you know, that's not really fair because there are some people that are only using 6,000 or 8,000 gallons, and there's other families using 100,000 gallons. So where's the fairness and all that? But then, what about, I have several friend couples that have no children, and I have other friends that have 5 kids, and almost 70% of our town budget is for the schools. So is it fair that my friends that have no children pay the same amount of tax that the people have 5 kids?
Well, that's where you go with the EDUs then, right? We're right back to EDUs.
But,
and I've lived in Deerfield for 20 years. I never called the police department. Does that mean I get a discount on my taxes?
No,
I
never use speeding every day.
And I never call the fire department. Does that mean that?
Exactly, and that's my point. So
that, in some communities, they do. If the fire department comes to your house, you get a bill.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
But it's there. But, it's the schools are there if you have children, they're available.
I understand. Exist.
But if you have, if you don't have a sewer hookup, you have no choice. You can't use a sewer.
No, and I understand that. But it was just opening up some dialogue as to, you know.
Our town has to have schools. That's mean.
We have to have sewer.
We have to have a sewage treatment plants. That's, we have to. It's mandated. We really have to have a police department, and we really have to have a fire department. So, but how is the sewage treatment department different than any of the other?
Because as a taxpayer, I can call the fire department, I can call the police department, I can, if I have a child, I can put it in school, but I can't use a sewer. Because there's no sewer hookup. I can't, I have no choice, I can't.
I would like to see.
Well, I don't know, can you, well, I guess you could build a house in the.
No, I'm talking about my existing house.
Yeah.
Or you could sell that and move into one of the new condos you're building. And you'll have time to it.
That's only if the selectmen improve the connection.
I agree with John, though. He does make a point.
Yeah.
You know, you're asking to assess people that don't have access to a service.
Right, but
But at the same time, I understand John's point as far as what the businesses contribute to the overall town.
Well,
and
I do understand. What came down when this bylaw passed? What happened was, we had to do an inflow and infiltration study. And they had a lot of leaky pipes in town. So what happened is, 1 year we had a $250,000 improvement for the town to pay for it to improve the lines in the road. And then we had a second one, so it was $500,000. That's where the genesis of the idea came up to. Why the hell am I paying for that? That's where the whole idea came from. Because what happens is, we wait and wait and wait and wait until it's too late, and then it's so expensive to fix it that all of a sudden you get people that are ready to throw in the towel. Well, what do you think is going to happen when they turn around and say, oh, your sewer rate's going to go to $3,000 a year? You think people are going to be.
Well, happy? And I think that's my mentality of, you know, at this time when we set the rates, it was actually a little more than what we actually needed, but that's important because in years.
We've done that for years, and the money that we've always had a year of operating capital in reserve. So if you had a $500,000 budget, we always had $500,000, $600,000, $700,000 that was in there, but somehow it kept getting spent up.
spent up.
And whatever, for sewer use.
Studies.
Studies and stuff like that.
But we've known since, I mean, they've done studies and that since back in the 80s and 90s. And they've been, this town has been forewarned that you should be putting money away because you're gonna need some capital improvements. And for some reason, this town has ignored those warnings, ignored those studies. And you're right, John, they have covered the operational costs with their budget, but they haven't been putting in what they should have been putting in for capital improvements. So now we're at our situation here, going back from the 90s, all of a sudden we're 2016 here, and we're looking at a $32 million bill. Now, whose fault is that? Probably everybody's, because we didn't pay close enough attention to it.
But there's two ways of treating this, and one is that, you know you need a car, you can start saving for that car. When that day comes, you've got a good down payment, or you just buy the car and you make monthly payments.
Right.
And that's what we're faced with. Do we want to start putting some money away? And we know that we've got to start making some improvements, and we could save some of that money and lessen our burden of borrowing, or do we just, when it comes time, we just have to do it and borrow all the money and just make the payments that way?
I think we should be doing both.
It's a good idea. But I think along the way, applying for these different grants and stuff, and I understand the federal government does have some loans that if your rates aren't high enough, I understand that. But this USDA funding is a different, is a whole different program. It's more for rural development type things. So, and it's based for communities that have under 12,000 people. So.
That's
a yeah.
I think if we're going to ask all the taxpayers this year and some of the capital costs, I think it's only fair that when they have to have their tank pumped, that they not have to take it out of town to get it dumped.
I think
we had that one time, but I'm not sure why they stopped.
Or have a different rate for non for people that own septic.
I think one of the things there was some abuse when some of the people who were pumping were bringing
in stuff from out of town.
Yeah, well, that can't go. Right. If you're going to get pumped, you've got to talk to the Board of Health agent. He's going to give you a tag for $500 or 500 gallon tank, and that's all you're going to get to dump.
So you're going to get $100 a year benefit out of that.
Yeah, but
Jack,
I mean, it's
only if that.
It's nice to.
So I think we got off the track of
again
because of something I said. You were talking about fixed fee.
Yeah.
Somehow we got back onto the septic users helping out and whatever.
I'm just.
And I was just making an analogy that we pay taxes for the fire department that
right.
we don't use, the
sure.
you know.
Schools.
The
and
schools,
don't have kids.
And we don't get a fee. We don't get a fee for those things. Why can't we set a tax rate for the sewage treatment plants, which isn't based on the usage of it?
We could do that if you put it in a separate district.
Okay. But in other words, my wife and I live in our house. We have five bedrooms. There's only the two of us. Okay? So we don't use much water. Okay? But we could decide to pick up and leave tomorrow, and then somebody moves in with eight children. So the sewage treatment plant has to be there to accommodate.
Mm-hmm.
So I don't understand why why there's a user fee when the infrastructure has to be there regardless of how much flow comes out of those toilets. When you call 911 sewage and you press the thing, the plant has to be there. So somebody that doesn't use much of it, to me, is analogous to, you know, the parent that decides to send their kid to Deerfield Academy rather than Frontier. It doesn't mean that Frontier all of a sudden, you know, they don't need that, the income to make it work. So
to get to the flat rate type thing, I mean, how do you guys want to do this? The flat fee, do you think it's a good idea, or do you think
it's
a
terrible idea?
Terrible idea. Okay, so then we won't talk about that anymore. Okay, so why don't we spend some time, if you want to, talking about, I think, like what John said, is that if we leave the basis of the rate for the residential the way it is, you know, we might have to adjust the price per gallon going forward. Let's talk about, you know, commercial, industrial, and institutional. How do you think we best deal with those?
I think whatever you do, if the flatter you can keep it, as close to residential, the happier customers you have for commercial and industrial.
If we want
and
the
time. It becomes a problem when you start saying, well, you're going to pay three times as much. And to me, it's important to give the message to all the business people in town that you're being as fair as you can for them. And when you compare it to the regular residential rate, you can't be any more fair than that. Now, yeah. I don't have a problem with saying if you go over 10,000 gallons, you go up another tick in the rate. And if you go up 20,000 gallons, you go up another tick in the rate. If you go up to 30,000, you go up another one. I don't have a problem with a step increase based upon usage.
What about strength?
Strength is another one that we always, the only one we dealt with was Oxford Pickle. And we gave them, in their contract, because we have to give them a written contract, limits with TSS and
BOD.
BOD. And we've even fined them. We fined them, I think, once $5,000 or $7,000 because they exceeded the limits. Because we knew if we didn't take care of it, we were going to get fined.
But do we have any industry like that in the town that...
Berkshire put, Brewing.
Oh, Berkshire Brewing.
They're the only one. What happens is they should have a separate contract.
Yeah.
It's extremely difficult to treat brewery waste. It's one of the most difficult. It's right up there with dairy and chemicals. It's a hard...
They don't get any abatement.
I don't know if they get an abatement or not.
They don't.
I don't.
They can't. Yeah. So let's think of it...
So far, so good.
Let's just think it in that light for a minute.
Yeah.
So, what, how much percent of the water that they use ends up in their product?
I would think a lot of it.
End up in the what?
Their product.
Oh, it depends on how much beer you get.
99%.
And they don't get an abatement for every dollar or every gallon of water they use.
No, that's true. Yeah.
So they're paying a premium.
Right.
They're paying, right.
They're paying a premium to use the water and not in their discharge. I agree. We should look at the discharge.
But that's baked into how much they charge for their beer. I mean, really. Those guys have done extremely
But they have to be
well.
Competitive.
Yeah,
but,
huh?
They still have to be competitive.
Right.
Oh, sure, yeah, especially. Yeah,
so,
right.
So it's
a million competitors.
I don't know what it is, but, you know.
We can do with that specific, I think we can. And I have a proposal hanging out at the end of the meeting, but I think we should have an abatement. But I think in the case of commercial, industrial, institutional, we should require them to put a mag meter in.
So you want to just base it strictly on flow, not strength?
And then we'd test the strength, because part of the budget is to do testing on all industrial users and determine what the strength is.
Most of the industry in this town, I would gather, it would be largely domestic, because the process water is negligible, and it's just basically the workers urinating and defecating.
Yeah, I mean, you look at the industry.
But BBC is a unique animal in that the brewery waste produced is extremely difficult to treat and is probably the biggest energy user or consume. I would venture to say without any data whatsoever that probably 50% of my electrical use at the plant right now in South Deerfield can be directly attributed to BBC's output. And that's because it is so high in BOD that the bugs go at it and you use a ton of oxygen and that winds up the aerator and it uses a lot of electricity.
Well,
so
I agree with you should do some charge for high BOD and TSS
units. Yeah.
I agree 100%. But I think we just have to know.
But if you think of the businesses in town, like he said, I mean,
there's only very few.
Very, very few. I can't think of anyone else.
How much of a sludge problem is that product when you have to haul all the sludge out of town?
Well, the higher the strength of waste that's treated means the more microbes populate, split. It's a logarithmic splitting. Then that means we have to waste that much more often, then we're using that much more polymer, that much more electricity, and we have that much more sludge hauling to get rid of all the sludge to keep things in balance.
So I think that's where we have to get the engineers to come back and do a calculation for us and tell us how much more they're using at the plant and determine whether a surcharge should be put on, because we used to have surcharges on Oxford Pickle because of that. And we even required Oxford Pickle to have a pre-treatment. So before it went directly into the sewer, they had to turn around and build a station where they could turn around, like dewatering it or something, or watering it down so it wouldn't come out there full strength.
Well, I've noticed when they do their production months are like May, October is one of them. The BOD numbers double at the plant. You'll go from 500 milligrams per liter to 1,100.
But that's why we need an engineer to tell us what the value of that is, because there should be a surcharge for that.
Mm-hmm. One thing they do have a tank, which is great. This is a great thing. And they put the waste goes in the tank, and then they feed it to us sort of steady state instead of these huge slugs all at once. So that's a benefit. That's really well. It's very good that they do that. But the strength is the strength. And the more they crank up production, the stronger the waste is.
It's a great industry. Wouldn't want to scare them out of town.
No, I wouldn't either.
We have to look at it because they don't get...
But it does impact the plant exponentially.
Well, we have to see if that charge is really worth the charge. It's costing.
I came from a plant in Virginia that 65% of the flow was from Anheuser-Busch. And they had to double the plant capacity and upgrade it. It was a $4.5 million upgrade. They went from 23 million gallons a day to 41 million. And it was all about Anheuser-Busch
and the
high strength of their waste.
But they charged them for it?
Oh, Bush paid almost the entire bill.
Exactly.
Yeah, they did. And we were moving out a 30-yard dumpster a day just from the hops in the flow coming to the plant. So it was very, it's a very, the yeast and...
Oxygen is around, the water around, pickle jars.
Yeah.
No. There was a discussion just a minute ago about ascending rates. I think that is an option that we can look at. It would be a certain rate if you use 0 to 10,000 gallons, 10,000, 50,000, 50,000, 100,000, over 100,000 would be a certain rate.
I think that's a good idea.
That's an option, but to calculate that rate, it wouldn't be a flat fee.
It'd have to be like a 2% average or something.
It's going to be based on usage.
Right.
So each use class, if the more you use, the more you would pay.
Why are we penalizing the people who use a lot more? The cost of, there's no change in the cost.
Right.
That's now you're going to promote conservation. Mm-hmm. Conservation is our enemy in this situation.
Is it our enemy though? If it costs more, the inflow, he said earlier.
By the same token, he said the biggest problem right now is lack of flow.
Right.
So now you're going to
promote. Yeah, this is an extraordinarily dry year.
Right? Well,
that's a big part. That's because we have INI issues too.
Yeah.
I mean, normally I get 400,000 a day. That's normal.
But isn't that...
But the other side of it is, it's going to drive the water district rates up also when you start promote conservation.
But isn't 400,000 gallons, isn't your plant operate good at that amount?
Yeah.
Because the strength is a little less. And I don't know all the technical things. You've told me so many times, but I can't absorb
it. I don't know what you're asking anymore.
Well, I mean, is it more difficult to run the plant when you're only processing 250,000 versus 400,000?
There are things that are more difficult, yes.
So if, in a perfect world, we just had 400,000 all the time.
For example, we normally return sludge to the aeration tank 24 hours a day, unless we're storing to waste.
Yeah.
Okay. We also have a policy where we keep a zero blanket in the clarifier. And so you have to return enough to keep the settled sludge blanket zero in there so that the bugs can be in the system doing what they do best, which is consuming the polluting constituents. All right? When the flow is this low, once your return rate gets up to around 150% of the flow, you can over-return and you can actually set up conditions to cause filamentous bacteria growth, that create problems and headaches for you. Now I have to chlorinate to kill the filaments, hoping that I don't kill the other bugs. There's all these little things that start to happen when, or I can't set my pump low enough without having the pipe itself kind of get clogged from lack of flow going through it.
Right.
The sludge will actually start to settle in the pipe, and it'll start off, say, 100,000 gallons a day return rate, and I'll come in the next morning and it's at 15,000 without any change in settings whatsoever, because it just cannot operate at that low end.
Right.
I need to have it up higher, and I can't because then I'm returning too much.
Right.
So there's, everything has its consequences.
Right. So like the conservation.
Too much flow, not enough.
Right.
High strength, not enough strength.
Right.
It affects everything. There's nothing that will not impact in some way.
Well, I can see the problem just being we have so many open-end questions as far as capital improvement costs, operation maintenance cost, everything. I think we need to, right at this point, I think the best methodology is, the present methodology, is to keep raising the service connection fee, because I don't care whether it's a small user or a big user, you still have to maintain all that equipment that goes from the discharge pipe all the way down to the sewer, period. And I think we need to bring that, continually bring that up, watch that every year, and I think that this committee, maybe once it gets over its initial charge, possibly bringing back a sewer committee to analyze these rates on a yearly basis to see whether we want to keep bringing up the sewer connection and doing the adjustments in the usage. Because we just have, we're shooting in the air with everything. We don't have a goal that we're working at. And part of it is we haven't prioritized what we want to spend. Now we're getting back to Jeff's argument last week. I think now maybe we need to take a break, pull back off the structure, and start prioritizing some of this list and go up that avenue for a couple meetings, try to get a focus of what we're looking at, and then revisit some of the structure. But personally, I think at this point in time, I think the best bet is just considering working on the structure the same that we had this year, is keep working up the minimum service connection annually and adjusting the usage to make up the difference.
I think, maybe thinking outside the box a little bit, maybe our recommendation should be not to establish how we're going to do a rate, but every year look at it, which is what you're saying.
Well, what I'm saying.
Yeah. And that's going to be the methodology. We'll look every year.
And get back to priorities as to what we feel utilize Keith's brain power as to what needs to be done most, and start focusing on that a little bit. And, this discussion of who we need to get back, of who's going to pay for what and so forth. But we also need to know what the back end is all about, okay? Because it's pretty easy to say, we're going to ask the town for $20 million. Well, then everybody's not on septic is going to get up in arms. But if we can get grants and so forth, because we have a handle on it, and say, we're only looking for $5 million, and with a sunset window, and then maybe everybody can start looking a little bit, beyond their own focus. I think this sheet that I guess you had developed out on the cost of septic systems was very informative. And, I think we as septic users, the ones of us that are septic users, have to get up to at least that level before we can start asking for input from everybody else.
Has anybody seen that?
No, I don't think
I've emailed to everybody.
I think we need to.
And what I did was a three analysis and three stipend systems.
Yep.
One was a gravity flow system.
Mm-hmm.
The other was a pump system.
What's the ATU?
Is the alternate technology used by DEP. They have some. There's a couple of alternate uses. So it ranges for the pump system of about $2,000 a year cost if you when you buy your house, your 30-year mortgage, you're paying about $2,000 a year for your services.
So I think based on that.
And with $580, which included your pumping fees every 3 years, which was about $100. But that chart, if you want to look at it, I think gravity system was like $500 a year.
There you go.
Do you have the email date?
Maybe it would be cheaper to put different towns or septic.
9/22/16.
I thought of that.
9/22 is when Bruce has dated it. I have copies of it here tonight, so if you want it.
I'll figure out the email.
So yeah, it was $583 for the first 20 years. And then I assume that in the year 20, the system failed. But you still had 10 more years to pay for it because you took out a 30-year loan. So in year 21, on a gravity system, it went from $583 to $1,388 approximately. So it doubled a little bit. I'm assuming there's an increase in costs in 20 years. So I reworked it again so it was a little bit less, assuming that it was the same cost in the beginning. So you either go from $600 to $1,200 in year 2021. So it's, but a pump system is about $2,000 a year out of your loan payment, or 30-year loan at 5%. And the EDU, which was running very close to a gravity system, was running about $900 a year. That included $100 in pumping fees. So where the problem really occurs is when the system fails. If it fails within the time frame that you're still in your 30-year mortgage, you end up paying for two systems for that period of time that you had in the original mortgage.
But chances are that failure was probably because of abuse.
Abuse or poor soils.
Because
some systems in Deerfield will put in.
Some of them, yes.
But even a lot of systems in Deerfield, anytime you get into that clayish area, even if they were put in oversized or whatever, you know, eventually they plug much quicker than they would in sand.
Oh, there again, every septic system is designed to fail. It is over a period of time.
There is a significant cost. And I did a narrative, and I also included what the town charges for septic fees when they go out and do a percolation test, what they do for plan review and inspection. There's, when you sell your property, there's a Title V inspection, which is around $600 to $700. There's a lot of hidden fees in the septic systems for non-sewer users. I'm not saying that we shouldn't pay anything, but we are paying more than the current sewer users.
Well, if you
want our own system.
The current
for our own
system,
we are paying more on average than a sewer user.
Okay.
And even at that, your best scenario, it comes out to about $40 a month.
Right.
And after raising the sewer rates, it's still $16. So it's...
Yeah.
When the real estate taxes are assessed, Bruce has some experience in this. In town, if the lot is on sewer, is the lot generally taxed at a higher value than a comparable lot non-sewer?
I tried to run that analysis through. Unfortunately, the way the whole system works, even though your card has a value for land and a value for building, one is weighed against the other to create a market value and a cost based on means with a depreciation factor, as well as to make the numbers meet the state. So there's a lot of jiggling around. I would have to say, generally, yes. To say blanket yes, no, I can't, because there is other areas that the land value is just as high as it is in the center of town.
The only thing
now,
that
what you do get is, of course, you get into your cost of services. You wouldn't need a bus system if everybody lived here right in the same area that the septic covers would be within walking distance. So you have that. the police wouldn't wear out the cruisers, because they wouldn't have to travel outside of town for all that. Your ambulance wouldn't have to travel out of town. You know, we've had roads that have, that the people have wanted accepted, and their tax rates have not been gone up just because now that the town is taking care of one before they had to take care of. So, you know, you can pick this all to death, all over the place. But in all fairness, it's got to be a community effort, and it's got to be worked out. But as I said, after seeing this, Bruce worked out, you know, we as septic users are not even up to the point, as town sewer users, are not even up to the point with a basic gravity system, the base cost of operating a basic gravity sewer system. So, you know, I think we need to work on that, and along with that, raising our connection fees to get that up there. And if it means we end up with a surplus, then drop the user fees, but raise the connection fee, because that is a fixed cost for every building that's in this town. If we want to start to cut down on some of this, it's my understanding that the sewer department takes care of the pipe right to the house beyond the tree belt. There's a lot of towns that cut it off right at the street line, and that's evidently a huge, huge line in his operation and maintenance is getting past the street line. So
the only thing that I wanted to add to that, to your question, is I've looked at, you know, tax rates in town for a long time, and my argument to that is that because you have a septic system, the minimum size lot in town is 60,000 square feet. It's over, it's an acre and a half. So if you look at the land valuations of building lots in town, they're usually around $80,000 or $90,000. When you look at building lots outside of the center of town, they're about $115,000. So, you know, you could argue that, you know, is there more value to have the sewer? I personally think there is, but the land value is greater for a building lot. But the land, there's more land too. So it's
a lot of dynamics.
Yeah.
You know, we all choose to live in this town.
Yep.
We all have to get along and try to figure out what's fair.
Exactly.
Right.
Yeah.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Right.
But I mean, I'm just trying to raise some of the issues so that we have a
Exactly. And it's good that we talk about everything.
Can we go back? I thought Bruce brought up an excellent approach to move this whole thing forward. And I really support the idea that he came up with as far as how this committee should proceed. And I don't know if people agree with that, disagree with that. That's up to you. You know, I think we need to maybe address that.
Get away from rates.
We don't get distracted here.
Yes.
A few meetings ago, I mentioned that Keith agreed that we should figure out what the costs are going to be before we come up with a rate methodology. And one of the rebuttals to our suggestion was that we have this consultant that's sitting there waiting for us to get back to him.
Yeah. All right.
And I said, so what? And I didn't clarify what I meant by so what, but I guess we're paying him. So we shouldn't be letting him dictate how
respond
get to him
to that. I've asked questions of our consultant, of the town consultant, to help us in the committee. I don't even get a return email. My question is, why have we paid them? Are they done? I've read at least four of their other studies that they've done, and what they do is they take what the town has, offer a bunch of alternates they know won't work. And they come back to you and say, this is what you want to do, this is exactly what you're doing. They're charging me $10,000. So when I ask them to give us information about EDUs, how they use, are there any samples in the mass, I get no response. So I agree with you, Joe, that we shouldn't wait. And I don't know if we're going to get it from anything.
We were to rush with our rate conclusion, so he wouldn't wait for us.
So that, yeah, I think it's not going to make any difference what we say at this point, is my gut feeling. Reading other studies and my reluctance to correspond with me as a clerk in this committee.
Well, I'll try to help that, because I'll talk with Kevin and have him get in touch with these people and ask them to respond to you.
The question I have now is, I think we're back to Bruce's suggestion. Mm-hmm. Let's continue on the same method that we are.
Yep.
And look at alternatives. Because I've looked at a lot of alternatives, and I don't see any benefit in EDUs, because I can't come up with a standard. A flat rate, I can't figure out how we charge commercial, industrial, institutional relative to residential. I'll hand out a proposal at the end of the meeting, can we, for our next meeting. And it basically says what Bruce says, continue with what we have. But I've added some things that we should also look at. But I do have, I've emailed everybody. It took me 2 months to get the 5-year capital plan from Western State.
Really? This, the one you emailed?
Yes.
That was handed out to the Capital Improvement Planning Committee.
I asked.
By Kevin a year ago.
I know. Mm-hmm. I asked for it. And I wanted.
Who did you ask for? Weston Sampson or Kevin?
Kevin, town administrator.
The $32 million thing?
Yep. Which is in this packet. And also the breakdown of what their initial cost for their scheduled cost for 16 to 17.
What'd you say? That's not a good thing.
I had it.
I know. I mean, I asked a couple of members, but maybe the email didn't go through. Yeah. But I wanted to have it so that we could discuss it.
Yeah.
Because mm-hmm. Without having anything in front of us, we didn't know what anybody was proposing. So,
shouldn't we?
The last 3 pages.
There was a video too. Did everyone get that?
Everybody got the video. We got a copy of the handout. Okay. Last 2 pages were the capital improvements. What I'm handing out to you is Barbara Hancock's. She gave us some reading for South Deerfield, Old Deerfield, which I didn't copy, which you have.
Do you have another one?
We're coming this way. Sewer rate calculations supplied by Barbara. The DSL bulletin relative to sewer rate relief fund. Sewer rate options prepared by John. I'm not sure if everybody got a copy of your spreadsheet. Something that I did, which I've changed since last night. And then Weston Sampson's memorandum for the 5-year capital plan and also the 2-year capital plan, which is the last 2 sheets, which was part of the presentation. All these documents have been sent to me since our last meeting, so I want to make sure you have a copy of it. I know some people have a hard time printing them out, so you now have paper copies. But to go to your point, the numbers are very similar except for 17. The presentation for 17 only showed $125,000 worth of capital improvements, and the 5-year capital improvement plan shows $1.5 million. So, and this is FY17. So there's a lot of issues with what they gave us, and of course they stated we are very preliminary. The intent is going to establish something for talking points. The last 2 pages of this.
What's this?
Of the package.
I'm not sure what you're looking at anymore. So the thing you just handed out?
Yeah. The last 2 pages is what you had. $32 million, and then I broke down the presentation on their proposed schedule for capital improvement, which Kevin is using. So, at least they have a point to start when we start talking about capital improvement. I didn't realize the capital CPC had.
No, I know. I know you didn't. I'm not. I'm just saying it's too bad, I guess.
No, if we were going to discuss it, we should have a copy. Everybody would be. That was my point. And we have nobody knew what 32, I didn't know what the $13 million breakdown was, because when they looked at, I looked at the video and they never discussed it.
We got, I got this, the capital improvement plan.
They did discuss this, you know, the 5-year capital plan in brief, but never in numbers, or in their presentation. Now, this was presented in a void.
I don't know, I'm looking over some of these things and it's just, I mean, just this morning, I had a conversation with Kevin about the $35,000 dollars for Captain Lathrop, and here they got $1.5 million. I don't get that. And then the Vector truck, I know we've had conversations. I mean, we currently rent it from Montague as we need it. It would take us 30 years to pay for that.
About 50 or 60 or 70.
Yeah, and then this thing about $25,000.
We get, I realize that. So this is where the $32 million was established, and I didn't know.
So that's, I mean, you look at
some of it, it doesn't make any sense.
No, I mean, $25,000 for sewer regulations.
So how do we know whether it's right or wrong?
I know.
An engineer coming in telling us how we establish the cost.
$40,000 just to inspect the manhole. I mean, whoops.
There's an IPP study for $50,000.
Yeah. They already did the manholes.
A lot of soft
plugs. We're going to do them again.
A lot of soft plugs.
We didn't do them all. I was on the committee when we did that study. We didn't do them all. We did them very randomly.
We found 4 or 5 at the plant that we didn't even know were there. They were buried under about 3 feet of dirt.
Well, they searched for a few that they knew what the potential they had problems. They didn't know where they were. The plans they had were very vague.
Yes.
And they knew every 300 feet or 400 feet they should have something, so they searched for those. So they were trying to determine what the condition was and whether they had to be evaluated.
I do recall that $1.5 million for the Captain Lathrop pump station upgrade was not only for the power supply, the pumps, and the physical part of that, but, or, excuse me, I think that was also to make it perhaps, I think this cost here was, as I recall, Tony talking about a way, Kevin was asking if there was a way to do away with the pump station.
Gravity, right. That was a proposal
to the gravity.
I'm not sure the selectmen signed that or agreed to that. I don't think they did.
They delayed it.
Yeah.
Right.
So, I mean, these are the numbers that we're faced with. Mm-hmm. We don't know how they were developed.
Right.
So that was the reason.
Well, these are the numbers they're saying we're faced with.
Yeah, and they're saying that the only reason they developed these numbers so that they could give an upfront cost of potential capital improvements to David Prickett so he could do his rate study.
Mm.
So okay. Without these numbers, the rate study would have shown no capital improvement cost. So this is why this was done. So. I mean,
I didn't realize that was.
So, can we get a second opinion on this?
Well, that was my feeling.
To make sure.
Do we need to hire an engineer to do an evaluation, which I hate to spend more money, but it is, are they working for us or are they doing this gratis?
Well, I understand Tony spent a lot of time doing this pro bono.
And with that, they're our preferred contractor for something.
Who's that, Weston and Sampson?
Yeah, Weston and Sampson.
So that we could, and I know that the next step to evaluate the old Deerfield treatment plant is a $100,000 design study.
I think, should we evaluate whether we want the old Deerfield plant? Shouldn't that be sort of one of the priorities? Pardon?
Request for proposals, somebody buy it, take it over.
No, but instead of, an option is to send the stuff down to South Deerfield plant.
I think that's, once again, that probably with generating this list and this package, that's something that we probably, our next meeting, should start to at least look over and discuss.
Yeah, I don't think we can make decisions about either plant until we know what we're going to do with Old Deerfield.
Right, exactly. Are we going to upgrade? Are we going to close it down, run it all the way down South Deerfield? What's cost effective? What's not? Those are, I think those are questions that we need to ask, and those are answers that we need to get.
Anderson and Nichols did back in the '60s.
The deck in the back room, in the back storage area. In 2017, old Deerfield wastewater treatment plant, planning phase, design, recommissioning is one of the items that they listed as a potential cost of $100,000. So we're talking planning phase, for design and decommissioning. So whether you're gonna keep it or not keep it, it's gonna cut, Weston Sampson wants $100,000, I'll tell you that. Just bringing the numbers to you that are on of record.
I would think if we can talk and think about, you know, the cost of piping it to South Deerfield.
We don't know that.
I know we don't know that, but if we...
You need an engineer to tell us that.
Another one.
Potential is, you need somebody to tell you that how much flow you're gonna have, you're gonna peak flows, what your pump sizes are gonna be, how big the wet wells can be, how much storage you'll need for the power outage, you're gonna need power at every pump station, what the maintenance is gonna cost you to maintain those pump stations, how many we need, you know, what are we gonna disturb, where are we gonna put it, are we gonna allow people to hook onto it? This is a major discussion.
Oh, yeah. But do we wanna spend millions of dollars on the old Deerfield plant? And then find out later it would have been better to close it?
No, I agree. But how, who's gonna tell us that?
What does...
Are you gonna tell us that?
No, no.
That's my recommendation.
I think maybe, I hate to spend money, more money on engineers, but maybe we need to do it.
So can we assume that that's, we decommission, and we'll then go through and have an engineer establish the decommissioning cost? When he does that, he'll have to have an alternate design, which will have to be paid for first.
Have you asked Tony to come and explain this? Because he will. And I think...
We have asked at our first meeting that they come and make a presentation to us, and it was postponed for 2 weeks because of the headworks design project, and there's been no offer to come since that day.
So wait, does Keith, I'm sorry, I didn't understand what you said. Are you in favor of decommissioning?
Absolutely.
What's the flow into that plant?
The flow is, it ranges from 25,000 in the summer up to 40,000 in the summer and 100,000 in the winter.
We have about 31 private customers up there.
And the rest of the schools?
It's all schools.
Out of 168.
It's like night and day when the schools are out.
31.
It's crazy.
It's very difficult to operate that plant.
Wasn't that, when you looked at those spreadsheets, wasn't it an eye opener?
That's, you know, that's, as I said, you know, reading yours, that's exactly the same numbers that I had down for
Is everything in old Deerfield gravity fed?
It was mind-boggling. Well, Deerfield, South Deerfield was, too.
Yeah, South Deerfield was crazy.
That's why, that's, you know, if you had asked me a month ago, you know, if I considered bumping that up to $100 minimum on both ends, I would have said no way. But after working that spreadsheet, it's like...
With the number of commercial...
I would have liked to see it go higher, but I didn't think you could swallow anymore.
It did go higher, so...
Yes.
On the rate, yeah.
The retired interim town administrator mentioned that we had impact fees and new sewer connection fees, but do we have the information as to what they are?
I don't know that answer.
So I asked him.
You asked him, but he didn't know.
But he said that the town had put them in. And I asked him for more detail.
Impact fees relative to new development?
Yeah, since somebody's going to put a new development.
I have not read anything in our bylaws or subdivision regulations or zoning bylaws.
I think he tried to tell us that we had something. I'm just trying to fish to see if it does exist.
It would be in this planning as the subdivision regulations. Because those are the ones that would impose impact fees. The planning board.
For the sewer?
Any development. So if you had a development, they install sewer water, drainage, they increase school enrollment, they increased the highway department, all those could require an impact fee. I don't believe that the town of Deerfield has an impact fee.
I don't think so either.
I know if you, I was in Hadley one day a while back, and a restaurant there that I like to go to once, they put on seating for 10 more people, and I had to pay a huge impact fee for the sewer.
Yeah.
And, you know, it's significant, and...
But we don't have much left, land left to develop. And do we want the land that we do have, we want to develop. We don't want to require additional fees that would restrict development. We put enough land in open space and preservation, that there's not much left land to build on.
It's a little too little, it's too little too late.
Yeah, for impact fees. It could have been when you were growing.
Actually, wouldn't affect what's on Sugarloaf Street, because they've already filed a preliminary subdivision. I think they get a freeze when you go to put something else in.
They have about 7 month freeze right now.
Yeah.
So nothing could be done, James.
So you would be interested if I could speak with Tony myself?
Sure.
Poke prod and get him to come?
I think we need somebody to, if we're going to move away from the rates, which I think is a good idea, I think we've exhausted our options. We've talked about it. Really don't have any major solution other than continuing what we have. We have some good comments that we can add to that process and how we might improve the process. But I think you're right. We should now move to look at what do we want to do, because that's going to impact the rate more than anything we discuss.
I think Tony is possibly a little upset with the town, because a lot of the effort that went into this data was done pro bono by him.
Of course it was.
And he feels like he got nowhere, so it was all for nothing. And I think that Wes and Sampson in general is starting to feel like they give a lot of advice to this town that just never gets acted on. So it's like, why bother?
Understood.
I think that's what's starting to happen.
Well, I think when you look at the budget that is in this book that was handed out by David Pritchett, the budget includes about a $400,000 capital expense in FY17. Plus several studies that they would do. So the question is, are we going, I mean, that's going to happen during the budget process. Whether those are get approved, not recommended. It's going to be the Finance Committee and the Board of Selectmen. So it might be worthwhile.
For 17 or 18?
17.
We're in 17.
They're talking about fiscal year 17.
We're in fiscal year 17.
Right, but the rates we established, their budget is a year behind. And we're not talking, the sewer department has a 16 budget to work on.
We just set their FY17 rates.
Right, so when they come to ask for a budget review, it's going to be for fiscal year 17, which is the year coming June.
18.
Yeah, we're already in FY17.
We're in 17.
We're in 17.
July 1st was the beginning.
Halfway through it.
So that we.
So all that stuff has already been scratched.
Well, it's the same.
That's
so we're a year behind on this chart.
Right. Exactly. Yes. Exactly.
Okay.
So I'm confused.
And it's like making a sales presentation. Right. People put a lot of work into making a sales presentation, mm-hmm. And that's what I consider. Most of this stuff is a sales presentation. You know, they've got to convince we, the customers, that we need to do all these things and how we go about it.
Yeah, and then they can engineer it.
And they're going to get the fee on the engineering.
Yep.
John.
I
think what we should
take
do
issue
maybe
with
next
that.
Month.
I'm sorry.
See if we can turn around and get
I think that's a really dark way to look at
this
it.
Whole page. I personally have a lot of questions on it.
Yeah.
Like, for example, task number one. Sewer rate study and wastewater financial model update, $18,000.
Yeah.
We just spent $10,000 for the sewer study.
Rate study.
Yeah,
but that's,
study. and that's what they're talking about.
Every year they want $2,000.
And then every year they want $2,000. What do they want the $2,000 for?
They want to make sure that we're...
So every year they're going to come in and talk to you and say, give me another $2,000.
They're just going to update, you got to take out data and update it again.
Yes.
But these guys just did it, and they just set the rates for this year, and I think we're all set. My personal opinion is I don't think we need 2000 fiscal year 17, 18, 19, and 20.
I agree.
Now, that's my own personal opinion, unless somebody can explain to me why we need it and change my mind. The Edwards project number two, 1.5 million. Well, we've already said we're going to do that. It's already in the works. They're already working on it. They already guaranteed that we pay them the engineering costs, so it's not like they're doing it for nothing. They're getting paid for it. And then what we got to do is, meanwhile, they're trying to get the grant for us, which is good.
But what happens if the grant is denied? Are we still going to...
We're still going to do it anyway, because we're going to have to do it.
We have to.
There's several things that we got to do, and I think what we got to do is talk to the engineers and say, what do we really need and what's the priority? Like, to me, Headworks is number one. Mm-hmm. We've talked about that for years. It's time we did it, and we're going to do it.
Right, but there's from my point of view, the $1.5 million for Headworks includes a very large garage building, and it's also going to include buying land and stuff like that. That's something...
He said you can do all that without buying any land.
Mm-hmm.
Well...
I haven't seen the plans yet.
The plans that I saw showed it on neighbor's property, the majority of that building was a garage for the Vector truck.
Well, you're not going to buy a Vector truck, so...
We don't need to... But that's what I'm saying, that maybe this $1.5 million wouldn't be $1.5 million. You know, it could be decreased.
Right. Well, the generator inside. The GIS
mapping. Well, yeah, I do understand.
We already did the GIS mapping.
No. There's no GIS mapping. It's infrastructure at all.
We started setting up years ago to incorporate GIS.
Assessors.
Yeah.
Yeah, but there's no coordination with any other department. Highway department, minimally. Sewer department, none. Water department, none.
Manhole inspections, we did this several years ago.
Portions, and I was on the committee that we did. They only did 30%, as I recall, it's in the report.
I know there's some problems with some manholes. And that's where the $250,000 boats came in, because one manhole was collapsing and a stream was running right through it, and the town building was turning around and filtering the stream, the clean water that was coming into there, along with some sewage. And that one, I think, cost $60,000 or $80,000. And that's why I say, do you
for one manhole?
That to the sewer users?
That was for one manhole, was that?
One manhole. Because they had to turn on, pump around that manhole so they could reconstruct it.
Wow.
This was several years ago.
I did one on King Street. I feel like I gave the guy too good of a deal. and I'm just saying that, you know.
Like we had two bridges we had to replace in town, and we got through a DEP. The two bridges cost us $500,000, and if we had somebody else, they could have done it for $50,000 or $60,000.
Well, it's
just, and we had scientists on the town payroll for 5 years. They had to go and justify how many twigs are this size and that size and that size and make sure they grew back over a 5-year period.
Well, there's all these rules. I mean, bringing me back to that sewer thing I was doing on King Street, you had to hire police. So I had police there for the 4 days of construction, or so I thought. At noontime, the first day, the cop says, well, see you guys later. So, well, where are you going? Well, I'm done. My shift's over. I said, somebody coming? He goes, well, I hope so. Nobody ever showed up. Day three, the guy from the state says, or actually, I'm sorry, I'm down in the hole looking up at a state trooper sitting there, and he says, there's supposed to be a police officer here. And I said, thank God you're here. Park over there and start direct traffic. He smiled and drove away. Then the last day, the guy from the state department says, you guys can't be doing this. You don't have traffic control. And I says, well, you got a choice. You can let us finish, or we can all go home, and you can stay here and guard the hole for me. I don't care, you know? And he smiled and drove away, so.
Typical thing.
Yeah. Yeah.
Anyway, I have a lot of questions, like they have NPDES permit. Do we need to budget $5,000 every year for 5 years in a row. You do the MBDES permit, and I thought it was good for like 5 years. And if you do it for once for 5 years, why do you have to budget $5,000 for 5 years in a row?
Because I think it costs $25,000 to do it.
I didn't think so.
But that's what they're selling us.
Well, these are some of the questions that I've got. And I'm not saying I'm right or wrong.
I'm just saying, if you budget five a year, that's an excellent way. If it does cost 25, right. Hit it all at once.
Right.
Maybe some of those things are done that way. If you look at Captain Lathrop on this report, it's $36,000 a year for a pump station. It gets up to $1.5 million in about a certain time frame. But you're looking at, I don't know why it's only 36 in FY17 and 35 in FY18.
Well, it's that in itself makes, you know, if it's 1.5 for a pump station and then to Captain Lathrop, what's going to cost for a pump station from old Deerfield up here, you know?
Probably right. At least two or three of them.
That's what I'm saying. Oh, at least, you know, so
pump
it...
Pump stations don't cost that much.
Oh, I didn't think they would, but...
About 250,
but how much are we going to save in operating costs, you know?
No, I'm just saying that if they put in $1.5 million for a little pump station on one little street, just imagine what the ones would be to get up here.
Mm-hmm.
And you're right, you would need several lifts.
Yeah.
Now here they got number 8, IPP coordination. That's for pre-treatment for commercial plants. Now my understanding is we got one. So the question, why do we have $10,000 a year for 5 years in a row?
Understood.
Mm.
Why don't we do it 1 year for $10,000 and forget the other four?
Mm.
We went on.
We got one place.
There was
right?
A committee that worked with Weston and Sampson that agreed to most of the stuff. It says in the document that they worked with a committee.
Say again?
They worked with a committee.
A local committee or?
You on it?
What?
And the committee that worked with Weston and Sampson?
Yes.
Kevin was?
It was Kevin, me, and Tony.
Right.
Essentially. Kip attended one or two times.
Yeah, but I thought this was done 3-4 years ago.
No, this was done this last summer.
Last summer.
I know they gave a presentation in town hall.
That was last year. Well, we've had other meetings.
This is the first year Kip's been on the board unless he attended from the planning board.
No,
I was there earlier.
Yeah. So I'm just saying that
we've had other meetings
up
prior.
Why we think about it. I think it would be nice if you could invite them. I know that they're going to be reluctant to come make a full presentation, but if we can maybe narrow down what they're proposing in 5 years,
I think it would be better too if Tony just came without. He was very formal last time.
Well, he brought his boss last time.
And
but
there was
before he brought one of his engineers, which
was
a woman.
There was two or three of them.
Really good.
Yeah, they did a really good job.
First time.
Is Tony the younger guy with the glasses?
Yes.
Okay.
Tall.
Yep, tall. Yep.
Very well spoken, very intelligent, very sharp.
Yep.
Up on all the regulations, laws, what's involved in creating these things from nothing. I mean, he knows first, second, third, fourth steps. Just right off the top of his head, he can tell you exactly how it's got to happen in order to comply with all the regulations, the EPA.
We just need a better idea of how we proceed from here.
Yeah.
I mean, he was speaking to a group, there weren't many people in the audience. So
this is the one he needs to present to right here.
This is the group he needs to talk to so he can understand what the capital needs of the wastewater treatment plant and the infrastructure currently are.
And let this man here grill away at him about why $1.5 million and why didn't I?
I'm not going to grill away at anybody. No. I know is that you saw what it took to get $3 million for a school roof.
Yeah.
What do you think they're going to say with a $30 million project without real good adequate explanation? And this doesn't all have to be done in 5 years.
Right.
Realistically, let's say maybe we got to do $3 or $4 million in 5 years. This is where if we turn around and work with the town, repeal that vote, that's the wrong vote, and turn around and have a scenario where we take some of the commercial money and put it in there. That way we don't have to raise commercial rates anymore, and we can still be fair to everybody and smartly use what we already have for assets. But we have to do something We can't sit there and do nothing. We kick the can down the road too far, too long.
Right. Well, I think that this Headworks project is going to be a good initial start.
A good start.
Yep.
I'd like Tony just to talk to us about the Headworks, too.
Yeah, absolutely.
Nobody's ever, what if it doesn't go through Mass Works this year? You're going to die in need of this. So we as the committee would have to recommend to the select board that we go forward with something, that maybe not the entire project, but maybe something.
Well, you know, every time, my initial goal was just to get a Headworks building. Period. A Headworks. That's all I cared about when I first took over as chief operator.
Yep.
It was, the Headworks was necessary. I saw that immediately, how bad it was needed. And then Don had been trying to work in that direction, too. He had submitted things to the Capital Planning Committee prior to me taking over, and it never went anywhere. So I was a little miffed, I will say, when Tony got involved, because then it became, every time I saw him, the price was going up. But Kevin had a big part in that with the Vactor truck and the garage. And, you know, it went from the Headworks, okay, well, obviously we need some kind of heating, but it doesn't have to be so elaborate. It can be the Headworks with grease and grit separation and housed in a building just for it.
Inside of it.
We don't need this massive big reconfiguration of the existing facility and a new building and have it all joined and reconfigured and, you know.
And that's what we're trying to find out. And, yeah. In my role there as a selectman, I try to look at it exactly what you're saying. You know, what do we need?
Right.
You know, and what you, and I don't mean you, but what you want and what you need is a big difference. And
not really, not in my case.
Well,
no.
You know,
no.
It
doesn't impact me one iota. I'm not asking for things to make my job easier.
No, I understand that, but I'm just saying that, like, the Headworks project is an important thing. I don't necessarily think the vac truck and that big garage is an important thing, you know, because we have an alternative that is, you know, works well. It doesn't cost us a lot of money. It's cost effective, stuff like that. Yeah. So, you know, I'm going to try to always steer toward that way. You know, I'm not always successful. I mean, the school roof was a prime example. I mean, I really tried to educate the town, and they chose to go in a different way. And you know, now I can say that, you know, because of the direction that the town went in, they spent over $1 million just on paperwork and personnel that really weren't that, you know, beneficial to the project. And that's where I'm trying to see through that. And I think this...
None of the items I have asked for either plant has been a...
No, I understand that.
It has not been a wish list of nice things that would be great to have. It has been absolute necessity.
Right.
And I again, want to reiterate that I have no vested interest in any of it.
I understand.
I don't think anybody's saying that.
No, I'm just saying, Kip, that I have been doing my darndest since becoming chief operator to save the town money at every turn. So I don't... wish there to be, I'm hearing an implication somewhat from you I have this luxury list.
No, that's not what I meant at all.
Okay.
I mean, because I think the first week I was a selectman,
Tony,
I came down to visit you
Tony
to see what it was.
Tony has blown it up enormously.
And that's what I'm trying to, that's what I'm saying I'm trying to do, is I'm trying to read between, you know, what is actually necessary, you know, and not, maybe not.
And I will say this, though. The idea of decommissioning Old Deerfield and force maining it to South Deerfield, I think, is a very fiscally sound thing to do. However, it started with the Headworks. Then it became larger than that.
Yes.
And then it became the whole plant being upgraded. And
I understand.
It really needs it. It really does.
Yep.
Okay? We have all our eggs in one basket with much of the equipment there. If any of that heads south, we are in deep.
Right, and I think we all understand.
We are.
We understand.
We
all understand.
But then, it went from, all right, well, let's decommission Old Deerfield. Well, that's going to require upgrading South Deerfield first, and then it's going to cost a lot of money to dig a trench and a force main for all that distance.
Mm-hmm.
That's when the price started really going up.
Jumping, right.
So it's just been expanding and expanding. And the problem that I have with it is it's just to get my Headworks now is all contingent on approval of all this other stuff. which I never wanted in the first place.
Well, I
just, some certain things need to happen, though.
Well, I agree.
Yeah.
With you that there should be a phasing plan, at least we know what has to come first.
Yes.
In order for what needs to come second.
Yes.
What needs to come third.
Thank you.
And we don't have that.
No.
We have a list of numbers that don't really make a lot of sense.
Yeah.
And I think Tony probably can explain, if we are gonna decommission Old Deerfield, you have to be prepared, like you say, to accept that.
Right.
Then you can't decommission it until you build the transmission line.
Right.
And then once the transmission line's built, then you make all the new connections, then you can start decommissioning the plant.
Yes.
Doesn't the South Deerfield plant have capacity to accept Old Deerfield?
Yes.
Right now.
But you would, at the very least, have to add the headworks to.
Oh, no, I'm not saying, no, I mean.
So what needs to happen? We looked at certain items and the all the electrical components of the clarifiers are a mess.
Yeah.
I mean.
And there's only one.
There's one.
Mm-hmm.
The other one's got a major crack in it.
Right.
So, I mean, we need to know what are the priorities and establish a number for those priorities and how we can get, if decommissioning Old Deerfield is one of the main options. So
right.
Proposals, how do we get there?
Yeah.
And what is the cost of getting there?
You know, the other issue at Old Deerfield, I will say this, you're on a cut bank side of the river there, and they did spend $400,000 to do that erosion control project, but just up from there, the erosion is moving toward that road at an accelerated rate. And you can, in the winter when all the leaves are gone, you can drive down the plant and there are large swaths of area you can just look over. You're literally a foot and a half away from straight
yeah,
down.
That cost the town, what, $400,000 for that bank?
For that, and DA paid the bulk of it.
DA paid.
Yeah. And there was some grant money involved yep. in that. But just up from there, they needed to go farther and they didn't.
You can't remember that. River, I mean, the river's
going
to go.
It is, and it's going to keep.
You know that.
So eventually, that might mean the plant itself would have to be moved back.
Exactly. So you pick it up a little bit. No, you're right.
I mean, why even go there? That you talk about expensive, and it would be at the last minute, probably in a hurry, because
yeah.
it would just another Irene maybe really did some damage, mm-hmm. and now. One more storm away, and there you go.
Mm-hmm.
So it would have to happen.
Didn't Carolyn say there was probably no grants available for that because that was in a flood zone?
Mm-hmm.
Yep.
Besides?
That's correct. It's an island in the flood zone.
Yeah.
Yeah. And it's pretty intimidating during a bad storm. I've had to leave the plant 3 times when I worked there. You watch the water coming up, and it's... As soon as you see that water breach and start going across the road, that's when it's time to leave. And I've more than once had to do it. At the time, I owned a Corolla, and I could feel the water pushing my car sideways as I tried to leave there.
Yeah, that makes some sense, too, that maybe it'd be automized.
SBR.
Automated.
Yeah.
SCADA system.
Yeah.
That way you can work
yeah.
independently of being in the plant.
Yeah.
You can work from remote.
Yeah, you still have to go to do, you know,
minor things.
Yeah, landscaping or maintenance, things like that would still need to happen, but you wouldn't have to be there full time.
Right.
Right.
There's a whole bunch of options you don't know or
yeah.
haven't talked about, and I think if we have somebody that has the knowledge to explain it to us, and
I'll see what I can do.
That'd be great.
I will.
So, where would the collection point be if you're going to run a line to South Deerfield? Would you collect it at the existing Old Deerfield plant?
I believe that was our discussion, and since it all goes there anyway, and we could even probably utilize in some way those influent pumps that are in there already that are at that level 30 feet down, or upgrade them to more robust.
Because one pump station isn't going to get it.
Right.
It's not going to take the
no.
flow and move to the next pump
no,
station.
No, it's not. There would need to be another one farther up 5 and 10,
yeah.
maybe near Monarchs somewhere.
Do we know that one more will do it?
No.
We don't know.
We don't know even the size of the pump station needed to be the first collector.
Tony would probably be able to give you an idea, though.
No, I know.
Because he has thought about all of
process.
Us. That's part of what how that $18 million
That's why he said he's going to take $100,000 to review.
Yeah.
the decommissioning, which would probably include how you're going to, what your alternative is to get the flow to Deerfield.
Well, if you had a pump station at the bottom of the hill near my house, from across the street from my house, close to Monarchs, it's pretty much all downhill to where the sewer line is on Route 5 now.
Plus, you would be running a surplus electrically from the 30-kilowatt solar array.
Yeah.
You wouldn't have the aeration tank going on anymore. You wouldn't have the influent pumps. The energy use that goes on there now would be only a pumping station and some electronics, which uses milliwatts. Yep. So you would be running a surplus electrically with a 30-kilowatt array sitting there. And you might even be able to expand it.
Where do the sewer pipes start? Around your house that go to the South Deerfield plant?
They start at Yankee Candle's corporate office.
South, huh?
And yep. That's a private sewer.
And that's what's put in by Yankee Candle, paid for by Yankee Candle, and it goes out through the middle of the field.
Yeah.
So we'd have
to go all the way down to the fire station.
Yeah. So we'd have to pump, we'd have to put pipes in from Old Deerfield all the way down to.
You might be able to take it across if you got a hill or where Hippie lives, and you pumped it across the railroad tracks and you went down on the other side of the railroad tracks all the way down to North Main Street. It might be able to do a gravity.
Tony had it figured out where
that sewer line for Yankee Candle goes down Route 5. It doesn't go through
Route 5 and out of the field.
But they own it.
Yeah.
No, I mean, it goes from the fire station, it goes down Route 5 all the way past Beat's driveway in the road before it turns into the field.
Yeah, right. But it's all...
Not much past that.
No, I understand that, but it's past the animal hospital in that point.
No, it's not. Yeah. I don't believe it's past the animal hospital. I think they had to go out towards the driveway to pick it up.
Tony had figured out that it would only need to go to about Monarchs, and then he had a way figured out to tie in there that would also bring a whole bunch of new users in.
I think it was 89.
Users, I'm curious.
People who want to be on sewer and can't would be able to.
Condos.
A whole bunch of new users would be.
In 89 or 90. So. Myself and Jerry Gates went to all the land property owners on Route 5, and we hired someone to evaluate running the sewer. And we were trying to get the town to run the sewer to the intersection where the old drive-in was, and that the residents or the business owners, landowners, were going to pay to install the sewer main from the Candlelight all the way down to that area. And it was feasible. There was enough pitch and everything like that, but the town didn't want to extend the sewer up that far. But it would. I know they did. But.
So.
But I mean, there's potential for a lot of customers along that road, and that'd be a good place where you could have a betterment charge. And those you could charge. I mean, I'd be happy to pay $10,000 per building to connect to the sewer. You know.
You're on record.
Get you on tape now.
Yep.
But that's...
Finance
verbal contract.
But, and I think other people would, I mean...
It'll be 10, 20, 30 years. It doesn't make any difference.
I know that the people that have that medical building across the street from me, they pay dearly for their septic system and stuff, and there's...
They can't keep it occupied because...
The little motel there. So.
Yep, there's a lot of them.
They have... constant problems here.
Yep.
Mm-hmm. I thought somebody told me at one time that the system was designed and it's deep enough on 5 and 10 by the fire station that it was designed to go gravity all the way up to by your house, top of Long Hill. So it was designed to do that.
I think that it would.
It would be way down there.
Well, that's what I'm saying. Back when we had it done, if they said that there was enough pitch that if it was at that intersection, it was at Mill Village Road, that there definitely was from the old Candlelight down to there, there was enough pitch and elevation drop to run that sewer all the way down.
You can't get from Mill Village Road to the fire station without pumping it.
That's
true.
Yankee
Candle does.
Yep. They pump theirs?
They pump the station there. They pump all the sewers down to the fire station connection.
And the pumping station's on their property.
Property.
Elizabeth made it that way.
Yeah.
She wanted to make sure nobody could tap onto it and send it in.
That's right.
Well, where's Vesh tie in?
Huh?
Vesh doesn't have a pumping station.
The vets?
The animal hospital, they don't have a pumping station.
They can tie into,
Yankee Corporate.
Well, Channing Beach goes underneath the railroad tracks and over to North Main Street.
Right, yes.
Okay.
But it does not extend to 5 and 10 from Channing Beach.
No.
No.
So the vets have had to work something out with Yankee Candle. To either pump to their pumping station or run a gravity line to their pumping station.
So Kip, you're saying if the sewer went by your house, for example, you would tie in?
Oh, yeah.
New pumping station in Lot A.
Oh, sure. I mean, everybody, I think everybody would, you know.
The other thing is, if you run it by your house legally by law, you have to tie it within 5 years.
Yeah.
You got the 5 years, then you have to tie in.
I mean, I can't say that I know of anybody along that section of road that has problems with their sewer. But I do know that they don't last forever, and the last couple that I had to put in the buildings I did, you know, they both had to be elevated systems, and one is a pump system, you know, so it's just a matter of time.
Or the system is for the gables?
Probably underneath it.
Underneath it.
I was just gonna say that.
So within 5 years.
Happy to pay.
And I know that it cannot work that good because.
Well, it never worked good.
Yeah, it never worked good.
So within 5 years, everybody that are on septic would have to abandon their septics.
If the pipe runs by your house.
Right, but everybody would have to abandon their septic systems, even if it's only 8 years old.
And they would be charged, betterment charge, it would always be deferred until they hooked on, but they would.
But I think they only can do that if you're included in the district. Do you have to create a district, sewer district to do that?
No, not necessarily, if it's the whole town.
Oh.
Oh, no, that's, I didn't mean it like that. I didn't mean the whole town's connected to it. I meant that it's, you know, everybody in the town is, that's not even what I want to say. It doesn't matter if it's South Deerfield, it's one sewer system.
Also, for health hazards?
There's no regulation, right?
To, what was that, Jeff?
Are they, would they be required to pump their septic?
Oh, definitely.
Tank.
If you.
They don't abandon the tank.
So.
Pump them and then they get.
So isn't that an undue burden on the septic owners?
No.
So it works the other way, right?
Unbelievable. Come on, John.
I only know that because I had to do it down the gate.
Jeff, they leave the tanks in, they use the tank as a holding tank, they use gravity feed to a gravity system which connects to a pump station.
Well, it would depend, but I mean, my buildings, all of my septic pipes go out the front because I've always been hoping. What's that? Oh, no, Mike, well, no, I don't know. I think that I could reach, because where my pipes come out, they are below the grade, center grade of the road, but only by maybe a foot or two. And then the other building, it already has a pump tank to it, so I could just run the pipe over to it. Yeah, I'd be thrilled if that happened.
We plan on the next date?
Yeah, the next meeting date in the agenda.
How about November 10th, Thursday?
Nope.
Nope.
Oh, well, not for me, I won't be here.
Are we gonna, is the goal to get Tony here next meeting?
It'd have to be later then.
How about the no, I don't want to do.
Are we gonna sit here and?
We can.
Seventeen, what's EMS?
There you go. Wait a minute.
EMS is usually the third.
Third, so that's the third Thursday.
The 17th?
Yeah.
You got a town meeting scheduled there somewhere.
We do.
14th. Isn't it 14th?
Yes, special town meeting.
It's 14th. Yep.
You're voting on the 8th. We couldn't meet on the 7th anymore.
No.
So, 14th, and on the 28th. It's a long time, but maybe you can work it.
Monday the 14th? Or Thursday the 17th?
Thursday the 17th.
Thursday the 17th?
That works.
Of what, November?
Yeah.
I can't, that's the third Thursday, so I wouldn't be able to come, but.
So we'd have to go.
How about the third, Thursday the 3rd?
I'm out of town.
I know.
Well.
That's all right, you could meet.
Third in November.
pretty soon to have something really we want to...
I mean, what are we going to do if Tony can't make it?
Right.
We're going to sit here, we're just going to turn into bullshit.
Exactly my point.
John, I agree with you.
What? Oh.
Next thing we need to do is have a hard discussion about what the process is going to be and how we're going to go from here.
Right. Well, why don't we wait later on and maybe like the...
Does it always have to be on a Thursday?
28th or the 29th?
Of November?
Yeah.
I won't be here.
You won't be here.
I won't be here.
You won't here.
That's the weekend of Thanksgiving.
Yeah.
The week of Thanksgiving.
Yeah.
So does it have to be on Thursday?
No, that was Monday and Tuesday.
Oh.
Unless you want to wait till the 1st of December, that's...
How about the 15th of November, Tuesday?
We could do that. That works for me.
If we can get Tony here.
I will. I'll try.
Tuesday the 15th.
I will not just email him.
You're on camera now, remember?
I will not just email him. I will follow up with a personal phone call as well.
Drive down here and color him, huh?
That's right. Do you want a multi-million dollar contract or not? Potentially.
November 15th on what day?
That is a Tuesday.
But we'll just have to do it.
We'll have to play it here.
All right.
15th is tentative, but we have November 15th, October 15th?
November 15th.
November 15th.
You're going to try and get Tony, right?
I am.
And if Tony can't make it, are we still going to meet?
I will do that as soon as I can and let you guys know.
Well, no, we might have to move it back until the 1st of December, until when he can be.
Okay.
Maybe give us two alternate, an alternate date after.
I'll try to hook up with him tomorrow.
December 1st?
Or...
Yeah, December 1st.
The 15th?
Are you going to vote on the remote participation policy?
Yeah, if you put it ready.
What's that?
What's that?
That's where you put a phone on here and somebody can call in to be participating in a meeting. I'll be in Florida.
Oh, you're going to be...
How lucky you.
On the 15th?
No.
Oh.
The 1st?
December 1st.
Oh, lucky you. You're going to Sanibel?
No, I'm going to, I'm going to several places.
Destin?
I'm starting in South Carolina this year. My grandson graduated from the Army.
Ah, nice.
And from there, I'm going to drive him down to Georgia to his new station.
Nice.
And from there, I'm going to South Daytona. And from there, I'm going down to Ruskin, Florida. And I'll probably go to Sarasota and come back over Lakeland. Probably stay at Kissimmee and go visit some other friends around there.
Awesome.
And maybe even go to Disneyland.
There you go. Sounds like fun.
Sounds like 3 weeks, Jack.
It is 3 weeks. And drive down and drive back.
So what are we saying, December 1st?
We're saying November 15th possibly.
Or December 1st.
Or December 1st.
I'll wait for the email.
Six o'clock?
Six o'clock.
Do you want me to get it posted?
Six?
Second?
Do you want me to get it posted? The meeting, do you want to do the email to whoever's supposed to do it?
I don't know. What do we...
You asked me to take it on, I said I would. I'll continue to do it.
Is it, is, oh, okay. Yeah.
I'll tell you what to do, that way you do it.
How do, is that a position in the committee?
Yes, it is.
To post?
Yes. It's very important.
No, I know it's important.
It's the most important position we have.
I don't, I'll...
It doesn't make any sense.
I don't care.
It's easier for me just to get it out.
You do it. You're doing the minutes, you can do the post.
But if you...
If we want to do the remote participation, the board of selectmen have to do that to allow all the boards to do it?
Yes.
And have they done it?
No.
Yes, they have. Back a year and a half ago.
You guys want to do that already?
I did it.
They did that.
Really?
Yes, they did.
I, not me, but...
Are you talking about starting this right away?
You can check, but they have authorized remote participation.
So you want to make sure, Bruce, that you put something on it, will include the electronic remote participation?
Twitter, Facebook, YouTube?
Nah, I think it specifies telephone, actually.
Yeah, I think so.
I think it specifies phone.
Telephone?
Yep.
So we have to buy a unit.
The 15th, 6 o'clock.
Six, both of them are six.
You can't have a phone.
And the pound, or what?
6 o'clock, 12:01.
Just, did you know that these are technically illegal?
Let's keep it cheap.
Well, they become...
Wiretapping device. It's illegal to possess one.
You want a motion to adjourn?
Wait, let me get the agenda. Agenda will be discussion by Western Sampson, presentation or discussion?
Discussion of priorities.
I think a discussion would be best, sort of a pseudo-presentation.
Yeah, no, it doesn't have to be a presentation, discussion.
Discussion, question and answer?
Right, a Q and A.
A grilling?
A Q and A.
Okay, yeah, there you go.
Oh, we're gonna cook out? We're gonna grill?
I'll bring the hot dogs.
Yeah, bring a giant skewer for Tony.
Okay, yeah, what, to adjourn?